Marcos, thanks so much for joining us today.
Absolutely, pleasure to be here.
Could you spend a little time and tell us about your background, your career, Unqork, and your role there?
Sure, so I'm the Global Chief Information Security Officer at Unqork. I have a pretty diverse background. Prior to Unqork, I was at Gartner as their global CISO for about 4 years. Before then, I was at a hedge fund company, Bridgewater Associates. Prior to that, I was in consulting. I also used to teach cybersecurity courses as, as an adjunct faculty member. Absolutely, so a little bit of sort of everything there. And also, I was in the military, so that's where I got really started into cybersecurity more on the technical side.
Great, and then your roles and responsibilities at Unqork itself?
Yeah, so at Unqork, I'm responsible for everything from the internal side of security, so ensuring that our employees are safe and our endpoints and technology is protected. Also the platform security as well, so ensuring that our customers that are building applications on the platform, they're doing so securely. So I have a team that's focused on strategy and risk management, another team focused on product security, so working really closely with our developers, making sure that our infrastructure is secure because we deliver the platform as a SaaS product. Mm-hmm. So from an infrastructure perspective, we have to deal with all the accounts and in the back-end ecosystem. I have another team that's focused on threat detection and response, so everything from alerting, monitoring, logging, incident response. And then I have another team that's focused on customer application security. So really working closely with our professional services organization and our customers to ensure that the applications that they're building with no code, that they're done securely.
So Marcos, tell me a little bit about Unqork.
So Unqork is an enterprise no-code SaaS platform that allows enterprises to build complex applications without writing a single line of code. We serve customers in financial services, insurance, healthcare, and the federal government, and have to work with them to ensure that they're building out secure applications without writing code.
Fantastic. So as security teams have evolved over the years and more adoption of cloud has happened, we've seen a shift from sort of what I'll call the traditional point and click security operations versus security engineering, building security as code, deploying through pipelines, that sort of thing. Could you share with us a little bit how that change has happened at Unqork?
Sure, absolutely. So I think really it's twofold. One, working really closely with our developers, our engineers to, to use a buzzword, shift left. And I think really trying to figure out how to operationalize that. And I think it extends beyond tools. Tools is absolutely a big piece, ensuring that you can be a part of that developer's process, that pipeline, everything from pre-commit to commit hooks, checking for things such as are we using the appropriate design patterns that were already pre-vetted and pre-approved, running certain scans, and if certain conditions are not met, perhaps ensuring that not allowing that build to proceed forward, things of that nature. So I think that's one big aspect of it. The second, kind of as you alluded to, ensuring that the security teams are using code themselves as necessary to ensure automation, to ensure scalability. This is key as you think about threat intelligence and enrichment and monitoring. Trying to monitor at scale really requires the appropriate technology and engineering expertise to kind of keep up and do so.
So Marcos, another change we've seen is sort of the perception of the CISO over the years. Not too long ago, the CISO was viewed as a technical security expert who basically just kept the company safe and was referred to when things went bad, right? Mm-hmm. But what we've seen it sort of evolve into is the CISO being a business partner and a business enabler for the larger business. So I was wondering if there's been any examples that you have where maybe you had a security program or problem that you were solving that also happened to solve a business problem or maybe vice versa.
Sure. It's a great question. We actually had a high profile government customer, federal customer, that had an extremely high bar for security. And as part of that, the business, as you may imagine, they were excited. They wanted to make sure that we can land this particular customer. But in order to do business with this customer, we had to meet some very stringent security requirements, which included only using these services and tools that they had already vetted and approved through their very rigorous kind of security assessment program. So essentially, we had three options. Option one was to onboard all the pre-approved and already vetted services, as well as tools that the government had already authorized. As you may imagine, we did not have the appropriate logging pipelines for those different tools. They all have different formats. Sometimes the field names and the like would be different. And so trying to do all the work to analyze that and to onboard it into our existing pipelines likely would have been a challenge. The second option was to seek approval from the government for our existing tools and our services that we were already using. The challenge there was, as you may imagine, is a very hefty process to go through that full review and assessment. And we likely would have delayed the project. We likely would have perhaps not even gotten that approval. And so ultimately, we didn't want to slow down the business's momentum. Option three would have been really just ingesting all of those logs into our SIM directly from a raw log format perspective. As you may imagine, that's cost prohibitive. Trying to ingest all of those logs from new services, new tools, is gonna raise the cost. And so we essentially looked at it from a perspective of how do we weigh the pros and cons? What is the appropriate mechanism to make a decision so that we can enable the business to move quickly to close this deal? We can still ensure that we have a level of visibility and monitoring from a security perspective, and we meet the requirements that are bestowed upon us by this customer. So our decision was, we're essentially going to go with option one, which was to use the existing tools. But how could we rapidly onboard those new tools and ingest them into a data model that made sense for us from a monitoring perspective? So we decided to build a new cloud native serverless logging solution. Essentially, that solution allowed us to parse the logs, to normalize the logs, and to inline filter those logs. So happy to go into the details if you like.
Please do.
Sure. So essentially, we use cloud native AWS services. And so the logs in their raw pre-processed format will go into S3. We use SNS to send a message and notification to SQS. SQS was configured with the Lambda function as that log processor front door. And so once a new log was available and needed to be processed, that front door would pick it up in that S3 bucket. And then from there, it would look at the type of log that it is. And so over a dozen kind of log types and log formats. And then it would spawn out to another set of queues as well as Lambda functions based upon that specific log type. For example, it could be WAF logs, it could be load balancer logs, et cetera. And that's because each log type had to be processed differently. Some log types were in JSON, others were in text format.
Sure.
Some were very difficult to process. And so they spawned out to those individual queues and Lambda functions where it was parsed, it was normalized, it was filtered. And then from there, it would go off to a final queue and Lambda function where it would then be sent out to our worm SIM storage. So we had to build that out in about 2 months' time, which was quite the feat that we embarked upon. But the team did a very proud of my threat detection and response team to build that solution in the time that it was built. Ultimately, it met the requirements of our government customer. Our business was happy. We were able to land the deal. We were able to do so in a way that maintained security and maintained visibility. We were able to ingest all of those logs, and having them normalized in our schema and our data model was very important from an enrichment perspective, from a data monitoring and alerting perspective, and so forth. So at the end of the day, we filtered down to keep only 1/100th of the logs that were pushed to that SIM storage.
Oh, wow.
And so when you think about the ability to scale that, it's massive. When we sort of scale that architecture, now we're looking at probably seven figures of cost savings to the business, while also allowing the business to seal that deal with the government customer.
I would call that significant business impact.
Absolutely.
So have you been able to leverage that system that you built across other customers that you've had, or use that as an enticement to get other customers to use your products?
So not just yet. That is a new design pattern that we're now looking at. How do we scale this across other customer environments as well? Because ultimately, it's a good opportunity for us to take advantage of that scalability, that elasticity, and using that common data model. The other benefit of that data model is we also on the back end build visualizations based on those log sources as well. So that way an analyst can look at it, and all that normalization allows them to do that comparison in a more visual way, as opposed to needing to go through and sift through raw logs.
That's great to hear. Somewhat in the same tangent, We found that many of our most successful customers have a very strong security culture, right? So security is baked in early in the development process, but it spans across all lines of business and every job description within the organization. Can you talk a little bit about the security culture at Unqork and what you do, what mechanisms you put in place to help sort of reinforce that and keep it going?
Absolutely. One of the things that I like to mention is the fact that Unqork hired a security officer before hiring their first engineer.
Oh, wow.
And that's actually one of the reasons I joined Unqork. And so having that level of buy-in and sponsorship on security from day one kind of permeates throughout our organization and our culture. And so I can leverage that as part of working through helping to reinforce that culture.
Absolutely.
Whether within my leadership team, whether across the organization as I'm having different discussions, the different councils and committees and so forth. And so we have a wide variety of mechanisms that we use to ensure that we're providing awareness, whether it's just through regular general trading, ad hoc kind of spot reports around what's happening around the world, how our employees can help as part of that. And so we're always looking at ways also to level up our developers. And so one of the things that we're working through now is training them on how to threat model their own application. Talking about shifting security left, there's a lot of ways in which you can do that. As I mentioned, you know, some of it's tools, but it's also how do you help build that mindset? How do you shift behaviors and thinking? And I think one of the best ways to do that is to help them understand what could go wrong within their application. What are the things that they want to look for? It won't be perfect, and that's fine, but it's a step in the right direction.
Marcos, thank you so much for joining me today.
Absolutely, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.